Okay, Michael, so let's write down a few equations. Let's try to be a little bit more formal, a little bit more mathematical about this idea. So I'm going to try to encapsulate what we just talked about, sort of the line of least commitment, by drawing another line. So if we think of this top gray line here as sort of the line that gets as close to the plus points as possible without crossing over to them and misclassifying them, and we think of the bottom gray line as the one that gets as close as possible to the minus signs without crossing over them and giving you misclassification. And then the middle line is sort of in the happy medium, okay? So what you really want from the lines, all the lines that are possible between these two boundary lines, if I can use that language, is that somehow this distance here is as big as possible. Can you see that?
Yeah, though it seems like the gray line could be pushed out a little more, right? Because the minuses don't bump into it.
That's a good point, Michael, and I'm going to fix that by putting a minus sign here. Okay.
So I see.
I did the best I could under the circumstances.
Data revisionist history.
No, there was just an invisible point, and I just made it more visible for the sake of the reader. Okay, so I've got these two lines. These are sort of as far as I can go without starting to do misclassification with my separating line. And the line in the middle, we've already argued, is sort of the best one because it provides the least commitment. So that means you want to have a line such that it leaves as much space as possible from the boundaries. All right, Michael, so let's see if we can figure out exactly what that line is like. So the first thing I want to do is introduce a little bit of notation, right? So we all remember what the equation of a line is. It's y equals mx plus b. And that's just the general equation for a line. But here, even though we're going to be drawing with lines, we really want to deal with the general case where we're talking about hyperplanes. And generally, when we write about hyperplanes, we describe them as some output, let's just call it y, is equal to W transpose X plus B, where here, because of what we're trying to do with classification, the output Y is going to be some value that indicates whether you're in the positive class or you're in the negative class. W are the parameters, or W represents the parameters for our plane, along with B, which is what moves it out of the origin. Okay, are you with me?
I think so, but that's, so maybe we should get rid of that top Y, because that Y is a different kind of Y, right? So the top Y is talking about the Y dimension of the plane. And in the second equation, that Y is kind of folded into the X. And we have a new Y, which is actually the output of the classifier.
Right, so I like that. So let's get rid of that first Y, which is just the normal equation for a line. And let's ask what each of these things are. So let's just say that again for clarity's sake. I think you make a good point, Michael. Y here is going to be our classification label, right? Whenever we're talking about using a linear separator, effectively what we've been talking about, which I realize now we've never actually said explicitly, is that you are taking some new point, projecting it onto the line, and then looking at the value that comes out from projecting it. And in this case, in particular, we want positive values to mean, yes, you're part of the class, and negative values to mean that you aren't a part of the class. Okay?
Yep.
This is our classification label, Y. W represents, again, the parameters of the plane, along with B, which is what moves it in and out of the origin. Okay, so this is now effectively what our linear classifiers actually look like. Even in multiple dimensions with hyperplanes. Okay?
Cool.
So let's take that and push it to sort of the next level. Let's figure out exactly what we would expect the output of our hyperplane to be in this example that I've drawn on the screen here. So we know we want to find this orange line in the middle, which has the property that it's your decision boundary. It tells you whether you're in the positive class or the negative class on the one hand, but also that it has the property of being as far away from the data as possible while still being consistent with it. So if you're on the decision boundary for this particular line, which again is W transpose X plus B, what would be the output of this classifier for any point that lies along the line?
Right. If that's a decision boundary, that's where it's kind of not sure if it's positive or negative, so that should be zero.
Right. So the equation of this line or this hyperplane is W transpose X plus B equals zero for some set of parameters W and B. We don't yet know what they are. But we do know that this is the definition of a hyperplane or the equation for a hyperplane. And since it's at the decision boundary, it should give neither a positive nor a negative output. Okay?
Yep.
Okay, now, one question we can ask ourselves then, if we look at these other lines, is, well, what's the equation for the other gray lines that are right at our positive or negative examples? So to help you answer that, I want to talk about what the labels themselves ought to be. So just like we did with boosting, let's say that our labels are always going to be from the set minus 1 and plus 1. We know that our labels are minus 1 and plus 1. And so we're going to take advantage of that fact by saying, well, the line that brushes up against the positive example, we want it to be the case, since we know those labels are going to be plus 1, that the output of that particular line, that particular linear separator, would be plus 1 on the very first point that it encounters. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Okay.
And that way, the things that are that are kind of past the line are going to be above 1, and the things that are before the line in that kind of demilitarized zone are going to be between 0 and 1.
Right. So, in fact, given what you just said, what is the equation of that line?
Oh, I see. So it should be the W transpose X plus B equals 1 for the top gray line.
That's exactly right. And by a similar argument, what would you say the line or the hyperplane should be for the bottom gray line?
Analogously, it seems like that one should be minus 1.
Right. So we have the decision boundary we're looking at, and we know that the equation of the line is W transpose X plus B is 0. We know that if we slid that line towards the positive values, we would end up with W transpose X plus B equals 1. And if we slid it towards the negative values, we'd end up with W transpose X plus B equals minus 1. Now we can ask ourselves, how does this help us? And it helps us in a very simple way. We know that we want the boundary condition line, the one that is actually our decision boundary, to be as far as possible from both the positives and the negative examples. So that would mean then, I hope you buy this, Michael, that the distance between the two gray lines, which are parallel to that line, needs to also be maximal.
Yeah, that's exactly what we want.
Right. So we want this vector here to have the maximum length that we can have. Okay. So how are we going to figure out how long that particular line is? So here's a simple idea. Well, the lines are parallel to one another. We can pick points on that line to define that particular distance there. So just because it's really easy to do the math, I'm going to choose a point here and a point here. Those points have the property that if I draw the line between them, you get a line that is perpendicular to the two gray lines. Okay? And I don't know what those x values are, but I'm just going to call them x1 and x2. Does that seem fair?
I guess that seems as good a name as any.
And that is going to define the two points that I have, and the distance between them is in fact going to be, or the vector that is defined by their difference is in fact going to have the length that tells you how far apart those two lines are, which in turn, because of the way that we've constructed them, tells you how far apart your boundary decision line is from the data. And we want that to be maximal, because then we made the least commitment to the data. So let's write that down as algebra. The equation for our positive line, so to speak, is therefore W transpose X1 plus B equals 1. And all I've done there is substitute some point, I don't have to know what it is, it's going to turn out, that gives me some point on that line, okay? Or puts me in some particular place on that line. And similarly, I can do the same thing for my negative line and get W transpose X2 plus B equals minus 1. Now, we want the distance between these two hyperplanes, or these two lines in this example, to be maximal. And in order to figure out what that means, we need to know exactly what that line is. So it's the difference between the two. So we can just use our favorite trick when we're doing systems of linear equations and just subtract the two lines. We basically have two equations in two unknowns, and we simply subtract them from one another so that we can get a single equation that happens to represent the distance between them. So if I subtract the two from one another, what do I get?
Quiz.
Oh, I like that. We get a quiz. That is the correct answer. Even though it seems like a tight mismatch, in fact, quiz is the right answer.